And before I move on to a detailed illustration of phrasing length and phrasing shape, I'd like to say that the knowledge about phrasing here is a result of many years of research and experiments. And I had to let go of many ideas before I finally found one ultimate method, the algorithm of phrasing, that works for every single piece. And you can hear from my performance that it works, and if you try yourself exactly the same method that I'm gonna describe here in this video, you will see it works for you as well. So if you're looking for a clear answer to what phrasing really is and why do we need it, how to structure and shape phrases, and most importantly, how to convey all phrasing ideas through playing, then this video is for you. Phrasing creates a poetry rhyme in music. The rhyme creates a breathing. The breathing affects gradations, waves of weight, which affect your technique and fast pieces. That's basically how it works. So while playing fast pieces, phrasing helps to keep hands in a healthy tension because it helps to adjust, gradate weight while playing. And create waves of breathing, breathing in and breathing out with less weight and more weight, and that reflects upon hands muscle breathing, so hands would always stay in a healthy tension. For example, when you're reaching the main section, whether it's an interval in a motif, or motif in a phrase, or phrase in a sentence, let's say a motif, and while I'm playing it, I'm basically breathing in while reaching the main interval. So when I play here, I'm kind of breathing in, and as soon as I have reached the main interval here, I would exhale. And then I start a new breath, a new wave of weight with the next motif. So it would look like I'm like inhaling and exhaling and inhaling again. And that really reflects upon hand muscles. So if you don't breathe and play in the same level of weight with constant some sort of inhalation, you're kind of holding on your breath all the time, and after some time your hands will just suffocate. So you simply can't play fast this way without getting stiff. And so as you can see on the left side, there are motif slurs with the last more prominent interval, and on the right side, this is kind of my attempt to create a breathing pattern that I have. And that breathing pattern is aligned with the slurs. And the same you can see with the pattern of phrases. And the red slur is more prominent motif in a phrase. And again, exhalation here is more like some sort of expansion that I would feel while breathing. I was trying to trace it, and it's not exactly like I would exhale, but somehow I would kind of expand my lungs, my diaphragm. I don't know what is it, but it feels like exhalation. And with the sentences, and you can see red prominent phrases, it works the same way. Now, when I'm saying breathing in and breathing out, it doesn't mean that you need to start doing it artificially. It doesn't work this way. Basically, it's a natural sensation that you get while making phrasing with intonation and weight. Because when you make the full phrasing with motifs, phrases, and sentences, you would also start naturally adjust the depth of your breathing. You know, breathing in and out more or less, or most of the time it's some sort of a weird mix of deep exhalation with breathing in at the same time, or deep inhalation with breathing out at the same time. So it's very confusing to explain, and probably could never do that, but it's something like this. So the bottom line is, it's impossible to control it artificially from the outside. And that won't let you focus on any other tasks, by the way. So breathing is just a good side effect, let's call it this way, of internal singing with phrasing. That's all. Because phrasing creates rhyming music, it has to have a simple, symmetrical and balanced structure, where phrasing blocks, ideas, are connected to bars and not to melodic lines. And you will be surprised, but from a bigger perspective, when all the motifs, phrases and sentences are structured in a piece, this type of mathematical structure creates an even breath, some sort of a wheel that naturally let music flow in your energy, flow in your performance. So as you can see on the screen, a small bar slur is a motif that goes across the bar line, which, by the way, always the case in any piece. And so this is first motif and the next one. And by the way, all the length of the block that I'm going to show you here does not change throughout the whole piece. And keep that in mind, it helps in times when it gets confusing. So a phrase is two bars or sometimes three bars. And of course, it depends on how many motifs inside. It could be two or three motifs. So if we take a look at the score, the first phrase will have three motifs, three bars. Second phrase has two motifs. Next phrase has another two motifs. So you can trace all the motifs. So bigger slur is a phrase, motifs are inside the phrase. And a sentence is usually four bars or six bars, again depending on how many phrases are in the sentence. And you can see in the screen that for better understanding, I separated sentences with a red small vertical line. So you can see clearly that the first sentence will have three phrases, then the next sentence has another three phrases, then from here there are two phrases, then next sentence another two phrases, then this little climbing up, it has three phrases. And if you look on the third page clearly, this is like fourth, fifth lines, sometimes actually it happens very rare, but sometimes one sentence would be equal to one phrase. I simply could not connect this phrase to the previous or to the next sentence, so I just let it be as it is, and I basically make one sentence as one phrase. I mean here, this part. And in the recap, again, we have two phrases in the sentence, and then climbing up again, two phrases, and in the conclusion, the last two lines, again, two phrases. To shape phrasing, we need to find more prominent parts in every block. So if you start with the smallest idea, let's say a motif, then just make sure you always make the last interval in the motif more prominent. And moving to a phrase, now that becomes kind of interesting and creative. So in the phrase, you need to always find the main motif. And there are a few ways to make it. You can sing quickly, out loud or internally, or play. And usually, with your intuition, you can already feel what sounds more natural. For example, you have this first phrase. So, you know, like this, you can play this way. Or this way. So you kind of can feel that second one would be more natural. Now, if you have some doubts, that you can also pay attention to articulations, dynamics, harmonies, melodic contour, and rhythm. So let me just guide you through the whole piece to show you exactly how it works. So if we take the first phrase, and we'll take a look at the melody. So first of all, the melody is descending, kind of. Then we dynamically, we start louder and then we go with diminuendo to piano. Then again, it comes to the longest note, that rhythmically, usually the longest note more important. And also we have a written tenuta that kind of solves all our doubts right away. Now in the next phrase, the same way, it's descending, dynamically descending. Also, there are some articulations that show the more prominent part. And if you also take a look at the harmony, usually more prominent, more expressive motif has more intense and dissonant harmony. So this one sounds more intense than this, for example. This is just resolving. The next phrase, again, dynamically and with articulation, and also harmonically, the first motif more important. In the next phrase, again, I make middle motif more important. And the same here, first motif. Now, in this phrase, it could be a little bit confusing because if you look at the melodic contour, you're going basically up, you're rising. Which could be a sign that, you know, we're climbing, so second would be more important, I mean, second part of the phrase. But if you look harmonically and dynamically, again, it shows that the very first motif would be more important. He has this little hairpin, he has this more dissonant harmony. That gradually bring us to piano again, to more simple harmonies. So I made the first motif more important. Then, the next phrase, look, okay, I'll show you. Harmonically and by the melodic pattern, you can see we're going down. So first motif more important, and the same in the next phrase. And the same in the next phrase. Second motif is this, basically, the phrase is descending, so the first motif more important. And the same here. And all the next phrases gonna have basically rhyme this way, ta-dam, ta-dam, ta-dam. So there's a poca poca crescendo, first of all. We are climbing up in our melody. So every time, second motif, basically the last motif in the phrase, will be more important. Now this part, could be again a little bit confusing. There are three motifs, but if you look, the first two kind of repeat ourselves. And then the last one goes repeatedly up with staccato from piano to probably kind of forte. So it's much more expression than the first two. That's why I make the last motif more important. And in the recap again, I'm coming back to the same pattern. I made this middle motif more important. Though you can also make the first motif more important because, it's much more expressive. It has accents, it's higher, it's like on the peak of exclamation. But in my interpretation, I was just holding on to the main pattern where I made this more important. And over here, again, you can feel first motif would be more important. Next one. This is again kind of could be some doubts because again the melody is rising up, but dynamically he makes diminuendo. So it could be this way if we're making the first motif. If second. Natural for me if it goes together with dynamic, so I made the first motif more important. Next phrase has three motifs and I make the middle one, obvious, more important. And at the end, again, it's your interpretation, only your interpretation, so whatever feels nice for you, you do. I made second motif and both phrases more important, so here and this. Made second motif more important. And the same way, let's take a look at the sentences. So, again, very helpful when you separate sentences with some vertical bar line, how I made here, as you can see, blue, I made this time blue color. Then you can clearly see how many phrases in the sentence. The same way, use the same technique, melodic contour, use dynamics, use some kind of harmonies, just from a bigger perspective. So if I play all three phrases, so if I play them quickly, I can feel that it's more natural to make first phrase more important. Next sentence has also three phrases, and let's play them all. Fast, you can feel that the first he started with a forte phrase, you know, it's louder, and again all others some kind of going calmer and calmer. Even in the last phrase he is going to menomosa and it's much more relaxed. So first phrase more important. Next one is very easy. It's a descending sentence with first phrase more important. Funny when you play fast. Next sentence the same way, descending one, so first phrase more important. The climbing sentence is climbing, so apparently the last phrase would be the most expressive one, which you can see here. And like I said before, next sentence I leveled with a phrase, so last motif is more important. And in the recap again, we have a two phrase sentence, and you see it's a little bit different here because the first phrase goes menomosa to very low register with piano, and then the next phrase going up with mezzo forte. So in this case I chose second phrase. And let's take a look at the next sentence again, two phrases, and it's a obviously ascending sentence, so second phrase more important. Mm-hmm. playing. Something like this. And again, at the last one, I chose second phrase more important. So, again, you can use first phrase, it's all up to you. Now, you can understand everything about structure and shape of phrasing in a piece, but if you don't know how to convey this idea through playing, it's totally useless. So, you can only convey your intentions and feel energetic breathing through intonation and weight. So you should start with a low intensity in your energy, with basically zero energy, and then bring energy to the points of higher intensity. If we're talking about motifs, that could be more prominent intervals. If we're talking about phrase, as you already saw, it could be more prominent motifs. And in the sentence, these are more expressive phrases. Let me just show you what I mean. So, if I'm gonna sing the very first one, can I actually sing? Okay, I will try. If I sing it with resistance and glissando, and I have just intention, you know, it's all about intention. Intention will create naturally the energy and everything else. Then I'm coming to the last ascending fourth. So it'll sound this way. You start again with zero energy. It's not even really important if you want to try it in fast tempos out loud once to feel. Don't think about the pitch. The most important is to feel the distance between the notes and to feel the phrasing. Now, let me just give you some tip. If you're trying to make motif for the very first time in your life, then when playing a motif with intonation, first allow yourself to make dynamic crescendo. This is for the sake of better feeling of energy waves. And what I mean is, if you try to feel energetic crescendo, I'm not sure if I'm saying it correctly, energetic crescendo, like crescendo in your energy, for example, if you try to make crescendo in your energy, when it's written dynamically diminuendo in the score, that could be confusing. You will either lose a motif line, or while trying to make motif, you will lose dynamic you will make, for example, crescendo instead of diminuendo. So, for example, in the second motif, you see, the first one is just a perfect one because dynamically and energetically there is crescendo. So, but for example, the next one, how would you make, you know, if you try for the first time, try to make it together with crescendo. So it would sound something like this. Now, don't get me wrong, because when I'm saying that you need to make dynamic crescendo, you don't need to make this crescendo on purpose without feeling anything inside. If you follow phrasing and convey your intentions through intonation, and if you feel that it creates a side effect dynamic crescendo, then let it be. So if you feel, you know, coming, and it's kind of more natural for you also to make dynamic crescendo, do it. And when your sensations become more solid, Then, while keeping the same energy inside, you can control the tone with your imagination. So, in the second motif, I would make dynamically diminuendo with my imagination, but energetically, through my internal singing, I would still make crescendo. So, let's see how it goes. The first motif. Surprisingly, even though I'm making diminuendo with my imagination, I am expanding inside. So it's like diminuendo with expansion, I would say. So as soon as you grasp the sensation of phrasing, you will be able to make phrases and sentences following original rhythm dynamics. So this exercise is mostly for motifs. So that's about it, and I'll see you soon. Bye bye.